Hello everyone, bit of a different video from the last few, and yes, I know, I'm late to the party here, so I'm probably not going to get the best views on this video. But nonetheless, hey, last year we got a big budget dinosaur movie that was actually set in the late Cretaceous, and as someone who loves both dinosaurs and researching the geological record, I got very excited about this because of its potential to both have an exciting narrative and as a major blockbuster movie to update the general audience's understanding of what dinosaurs were like and how they lived in the latest Cretaceous. The positive sign was when the directors said that they wanted to transport audiences back to the end of the Cretaceous and show them exactly what the planet, its environments, and creatures were like.
And so we felt like it'd be an extraordinary opportunity to be able to transport audiences back exactly 65 million years ago to see what the landscape looks like, what the dinosaurs looked like, and how raw and dangerous and aggressive planet Earth was at that period.
So, with that being the movie's intention, let's have a look and see how well it did at it. Now, this is not a serious video. I might get a little frustrated by missed opportunities or inaccuracies, and I know that as a film, we shouldn't be expecting a documentary sort of quality work, especially since this is a product designed to entertain. But I'm just really making this video for fun, and for the fun of research. That said, it definitely would be great if some care was taken to present the animals at least somewhat reasonably. Dinosaurs were, as we all know, fascinating, unique animals with a diverse array of morphologies and behaviours, and were far more dangerous that it kinda goes without saying they don't need to be turned into monsters for a movie to work. I'm going to try to avoid spoiling the movie as much as possible, but there are going to be some heavy spoilers because they are inevitable when it comes to talking about how accurate certain creatures are. So be warned for that. My discussion here is really going to be limited to the environments and the creatures shown in the movie. 65 is a 2023 survival film following two aliens who crash land on Earth and have to survive a number of extinct animals that want to feed on them. These two aliens belong to a species that has somehow undergone exceptional levels of convergent evolution with modern humans, including somehow having independently developed the metric system.
Section of the Soic located. Distance to escape vessel 15 kilometers.
This is very strange to me because the meter is a unit of measurement that was specifically based on the proportions of planet Earth, with 1 meter being defined as 1/10 millionth of the shortest distance from the North Pole to the equator passing through Paris. So, how did these aliens develop the exact same unit of measurement? Unless their species comes from a planet that has the exact same proportions as Earth. It's very strange. Anyway, now that that bit of weirdness is out of the way, let's take a look at when and where we are. Now, the film's title screen tells us already that this film takes place 65 million years ago. This is very useful, because we know from an assortment of radiometric dating techniques that the end Cretaceous mass extinction event happened very close to 66 million years ago, as detailed in this article in Science, which is linked in the description. So that means that, in theory, our heroes should be trying to escape a world with no large predators, or really large animals of any kind, beyond the odd Champsosaurid or Crocodilomorph, and lots of small furry mammals. So, it should be really easy for them in theory to get to their escape ship, especially if they're away from water and... Wait, what? There are large non-avian dinosaurs here? And the movie is called 65 because it's set 65 million years ago, when dinosaurs went extinct 66 million years ago? Oh boy, we're gonna be in for a rough ride, folks. Anyway, we can also infer our location from the fact that our characters are shown to be in the exact area that the asteroid hits at the end of the film, which wipes out the non-avian dinosaurs and a ton of other animals. That tells us that we are in the Yucatan Peninsula of Mexico. So, if we're in Mexico, that gives us a pretty good idea of what kind of animals we can expect to see in this film going forward. So, North America has a very good fossil record from the Maastrichtian, that being the final stage of the Late Cretaceous. In fact, the fossil record from the USA is so good, we actually had an entire episode of Prehistoric Planet just set in North America that barely scratched the surface of the continent's diversity. Sadly, pretty much every named North American dinosaur from the Maastrichtian is from the USA and Canada, but plenty of bits and pieces have shown up in Mexico, which have sufficient features to be assigned to various broader groups. There's a very comprehensive paper by A.A. Ramirez Velasco and R. Hernandez Rivera on the diversity of Late Cretaceous dinosaurs from Mexico from 2015, which catalogues all of the known remains of dinosaurs from the Mexican Late Cretaceous that have been found so far. So, if you were an alien who crash-landed in Mexico just before the Cretaceous-Paleogene extinction event, what would you expect to see? Well, based on Ramirez Velasco and Hernandez Rivera's catalogue of findings, in terms of dangerous predators, Maastrichtian Mexico yielded a pretty large amount of tyrannosaurid material, including material that can be assigned to Tyrannosaurus rex, with teeth that appear to belong to T-Rex being found in the far north of Mexico. Teeth which seem to have belonged to a more Albertosaurus-like tyrannosaur have also been described, though I wouldn't be surprised if those teeth turn out to be from younger T-Rex individuals. These remains were, however, a long way northwest of the Yucatan Peninsula, and it is entirely plausible that another species of tyrannosaur might have held the top predator niche in this environment. We don't really know unless more remains are found from that particular part of Mexico. That said, based on North America's fossil record, you can definitely expect the top predator in the region to be a tyrannosaurid of some kind. You can also expect to see ornithomimids running around, that being the so-called ostrich dinosaurs. And although there aren't any dromaeosaur or troodontid remains found in the Maastrichtian of Mexico, there are absolutely tons of remains from these groups in the Campanian, so the interval just before the final interval of the Cretaceous period, so just a little bit earlier. And it would shock me if these guys weren't still around, especially since a lot of members of these groups are known from the Maastrichtian of the USA. So it's very probable that we could expect to see some so-called raptors hanging around. And the fact that we do have such a gap in the dromaeosaur fossil record for Mexico gives the filmmakers plenty of room for speculation and interesting designs. There are also titanosaur remains from Maastrichtian Mexico. And we know from further north in the southern United States that the giant Alamosaurus was present, so we can add large sauropods to the animals that they might encounter. Honestly, learning about this environment is already getting pretty exciting. We don't currently have any ankylosaur material from the late Maastrichtian of Mexico like we do from the USA, but we do have some material potentially from the earlier part of that time period, so I think we can list them as a maybe for something that our aliens might see. Now what about these ceratopsians? Now, material from both the chasmosaur and potentially the centrosaur lineages has been found in Maastrichtian Mexico. One genus you could probably expect to see is the giant chasmosaur Torosaurus, whose remains seem to get more common further south in the United States, where it seems to take over from Triceratops. And Mexico also has plenty of hadrosaurid material, both from the Lambiosaurine lineage, that is, the ones with the big cool crests, and the Sauralophine lineage, that is, the ones that didn't usually have crests, or if they did, had little ones. We have no idea what kinds of crests the Lambeosaurians present in Mexico would have had. So there's plenty of room for creativity there if you're a filmmaker. Same with the potential centrosaurine ceratopsids. We have very little in the idea of what their horns or crests might have supported. There's so much potential diversity and potential to go nuts with your designs if you're a filmmaker. So lots of exciting material to work from based on what we know of the Maastrichtian fossil record of Mexico already. We can probably also expect plenty more overlap with creatures found further north, like giant Ashdarchid pterosaurs and Canognathid oviraptorosaurs. And Ashdarchids were so utterly strange as giraffe-proportioned ground-hunting predatory pterosaurs that they would make phenomenal monsters without needing to change them up. So yeah, we have tons of potential for extrapolating on what we have in the fossil record from fragmentary remains and going a bit wild with speculation without necessarily being inaccurate to any significant degree. So, now that we've got ourselves excited about the known and the plausible Maastrichtian Mexican marvelous megafauna, feel free to completely throw all of that out of the window because barely any of those animals that I suggested show up. Anyway, the first dinosaur that we're actually going to talk about that actually appears in this film is an unnamed dromaeosaur that features in it. The reason I'm talking about this one first is just because it was the first dinosaur featured in the film. And I want to start off by pointing out that there is a huge elephant in the room here. Namely, its skin. The animal shown in the film is not entirely feathered, but it also isn't scaly. It has a texture that's frankly reminiscent of the skin of a plucked turkey. The actual anatomy seems to be alright, with the exception of some wrist pronation that the real theropods wouldn't have been able to do. But we know for a fact at this point that numerous fossils of dromaeosaurs have had feathers. I talked about this in my video series on the scientific accuracy of Prehistoric Planet, so I don't necessarily need to cover all of that here since I can just recommend those videos, but we have direct fossil evidence for both primitive and more derived dromaeosaurs having bodies covered in feathers and pennaceous wing feathers on their arms, with quill knobs known from the arms of Velociraptor itself. Everything about this design confuses me. Especially because thanks to concept artist Kevin Ishioka, the same man who gave us the ships and a lot of the scenery design for this movie, we know that we could have had this genuinely wonderful design that was both extremely intimidating and very accurate to what we know dromaeosaurs look like, save for some nitpicks with feather placement on the hands. I genuinely don't understand how anyone could look at a knife-handed murder hawk designed by someone who clearly paid attention to what these animals should have looked like, and decide instead to go with a design that looks like a plucked turkey, and lacks any of the threat factor or the accuracy for what the animal was known to look like. The second animal we're going to be talking about in this video is Jacopil. Now, Jacopil is the first and inexplicably only herbivorous dinosaur that we encounter in the movie, and seeing Jacopil was a very pleasant surprise to me. Jacopil caniacura is a basal thyreophoran, that's the group which contains the ankylosaurs, the stegosaurs, and the scalidosaurs, which is known from Late Cretaceous Argentina. Now, it lived around 90 million years ago, which is way too old for this movie, and Jacopil, despite being quite young in that lineage, is considered to be a very primitive member of the group, maintaining many of the traits from its earliest ancestors, including the bipedal posture, which is shown here in this reconstruction that makes it so recognizable. Unfortunately, the praise kind of stops here as we actually start to zoom in and look at the details of this movie's version of Jacopil. For one, the model used in the movie has a disproportionately large head compared to the material we have, and the film's reconstruction is shown to have a tail club, much like those of advanced ankylosaurids. Jakapil was not an ankylosaur and really should not have this club. As I said, it's also living about 25 million years too late in the wrong continent. Now, I'm not saying it's impossible for Jakapil to have had similar looking descendants in South America, but North and South America wouldn't combine for tens of millions of years after the end of the Cretaceous, and it's pretty unlikely that Jakapil would have been present in North America because of that. Another issue with the movie's reconstruction of Jakapil is the way the osteoderms on its neck are portrayed. We know from its fossils that Jakapil had very prominent spike-like osteoderms sticking out of the top and sides of its neck, with plate-like osteoderms between them. Osteoderms, by the way, are these pieces of bone that are embedded in the skin. And yet, for some reason, this movie decided that their reconstruction would remove the plate-like armor from around the sides of the neck, remove the lower spikes entirely, and replace the spikes on the top with a single row of rounded nubs. This movie Jakapil is also shown to have proportionally much longer front limbs, with much larger hands than the real animal had, and a much longer head relative to its height. So overall, unfortunately, Jakapil isn't really done justice in this movie, and that's a real shame to me, because Jakapil has already become one of my favourite dinosaurs, despite only recently being described, and this was its first appearance in any kind of movie or TV show or media in general. Anyway, the Jakapil gets killed by some troodontids, and the troodontids have the exact same issues with feathering as the dromaeosaur, so I basically just have to say the same thing about the dromaeosaur. There are plenty of remains of troodontids from Maastrichtian North America, but once again, we know from the fossils of relatives of these things that they should be densely feathered, and they might have even been more closely related to birds than dromaeosaurs are. So this design is, once again, very inexcusable and very disappointing. The next animal we're going to be talking about is one that Mills, the main character, fights in a cave, and it is a frankly bizarre interpretation of Oviraptor. Now, as I mentioned earlier, we do have fossils of Oviraptorsaurs in North America during the late Maastrichtian, but not actual Oviraptor, which lived in Mongolia. And we know from the titles of concept art that this thing is specifically supposed to be Oviraptor, and not one of the Caenognathid Oviraptorsaurs that actually lived in North America, which is bizarre to me. But as a reconstruction of, we'll just say, a generic Oviraptorsaur, let's have a look at it and see how well it does. First, let's look at its head. Do you see a problem? First, let me show you what the skull of Oviraptor looks like, so you can get a good idea. Do you see the problem now? No? Okay, so let's compare it with the skull of an actual late Cretaceous North American Oviraptorsaur, Anzu. Do you see it on here? It's the mouth. What is not in the mouth of this thing? Teeth. They gave a dinosaur from an entire lineage of famously toothless dinosaurs teeth. Why? The directors said that they wanted their dinosaurs to be scientifically tangible, that they were looking at fossils and listening to paleontologists. But their animal has teeth, and in theory it's descended from ancestors that didn't. So this dinosaur has had to entirely re-evolve teeth that aren't a part of its beak or cartilaginous. And it gets worse than that. Other aptosaurs were extremely closely related, once again, to birds. And the position of individuals which had been found sitting on nests that were consumed by sandstorms was in a position of using wings to shield the eggs from sand. So once again, we have yet another dinosaur that we know should have been feathered, presented as not being feathered for no discernible reason. So yeah, that's a bit disappointing. Next, we need to talk about a pterosaur, which shows up in the film. This pterosaur belongs to a genus called Zungaripterus. And this model is actually, for the most part, very good. You can see that it was based on a skeletal reconstruction. But it has one bizarre mistake. Can you spot it? Okay, if you know a little bit about pterosaurs, I'm pretty sure you spotted it instantly. They put the eye in the antorbital fenestra. They clearly based this on a skeletal reconstruction, but then didn't check where in the animal's skull the eye should have been. Now, should Zungaripterus be living in the latest Cretaceous at all? No, because this genus lived during the early Cretaceous. But we do have evidence for its family having still been alive during the early part of the late Cretaceous, though we don't have any evidence to date for any member of the Zungaripteridae family at the actual end of the Cretaceous. That said, pterosaurs, especially smaller pterosaurs, don't exactly have the best fossil records. And as we talked about in my Prehistoric Planet review series, recent fossils from Mexico have revealed that pterosaur diversity during the late Maastrichtian was a lot greater than we used to think it was, and there were a lot more lineages still alive than we used to think. So I'm not going to fully rule out the possibility that a pterosaur in this lineage might potentially have still existed at the end of the Cretaceous. But if it was, its eyes would not have been growing out of its antorbital fenestra. You know, the paleontological advisors that this film did have, according to its directors, must have really appreciated this design. You can tell by the fact that they apparently didn't want to be credited, and no one knows who they are. The next dinosaur we're going to be talking about is the movie's version of T-Rex. Now, the animal in the film is almost entirely shown in darkness, which is very unfortunate for trying to get a handle on the accuracy of the film's reconstruction. But we do have a couple of pieces of concept art we can go off, as well as a few screenshots that give us a reasonable picture. Now, in both pieces of concept art, we can see that the T-Rex has around 10 to 12 premaxillary teeth. That's the teeth in the premaxilla, which is the bone at the very front of the skull, and these teeth are a lot smaller than the ones further back. Now, in the concept art, there's slightly too many premaxillary teeth. Even if this is a separate species from T-Rex proper, and is instead a different, more southerly living Tyrannosaurid, all species within the Tyrannosauridae family are united by the fact that they have only 4 teeth per premaxilla, or 8 in total. We also see that there are between 6 and 8 teeth present in the movie Rex's maxilla. That's the bone behind the premaxilla that the rest of the teeth in the upper jaw are present in. That's actually quite a lot less than the number of teeth present in the real animal, which had an average of 12 maxillary teeth. Both models show 11 to 12 dentary teeth for each side of the mouth, and that's the teeth on the bottom jaw, which is actually pretty correct, with the real-world T-Rex having between 12 and 14 dentary teeth. Though the morphology of the ones on the models are rather unusual, to say the least. Anyway, now that we've needlessly criticized some stylization, let's have a look at some of the more interesting features of this model. Along the neck, we can see that the final version of the T-Rex in this movie appears to possess osteoderms, for some reason. Osteoderms, once again, being little pieces of bone embedded in the skin. Osteoderms have only been found to be present in one species of theropod, Ceratosaurus nasicornis, which was very, very, very distantly related to T-Rex, with its ancestors separating from the ancestor of T-Rex during the Triassic. A feature which you can clearly see in this shot of the attack, but not anywhere else, is that the T-Rex has visible quills sticking out of the upper part of its neck and the back of its head. These are a much more plausible feature, since we know that feathers were present in older tyrannosauroids, such as Eutyrannus, whose only known skeleton is covered in feather impressions. That said, we don't have any evidence for quills like these or any feathering of any kind in any of the derived tyrannosaurids, and we do have skin impressions of scaly parts of their bodies. So, putting a few quills in this design, in my opinion, is perfectly reasonable. The animal portrayed in this film has a distinctly more erect posture than any real-world theropod, and it looks very 1990s and has very pronated wrists, i.e. wrists that are sort of pointing downwards. This is something that it's now understood theropods couldn't actually do without breaking their wrists. The animal also appears to have a strange hump on its back above its shoulders, which doesn't seem to match any known part of Tyrannosaurus's anatomy, or its shoulder blades, which are actually visible in the model. So I don't actually know what this lump is supposed to be, but it shouldn't be there. Now, we have very good reason to believe that T-Rex's teeth should have been covered with lips similar to those of a lizard. As discussed in this study by Tom Cullen et al., the tooth wear pattern and rows of foramina that would support blood vessels going to and from lips strongly indicates that they were present on T-Rex. But they aren't present on this model. The T-Rex here is also much too skinny. Thanks to more fossils of the gastralia, which are the belly ribs of T-Rex, than we had in the 1990s when Jurassic Park came out, which clearly shaped a lot of pop culture's idea of what a T-Rex looks like, we know that T-Rex was much more beefy and chunky than we used to think of in terms of its torso. If you're interested, check out this article from the Field Museum, which is linked in the description. Yet this thing is just lanky for some reason. So, yeah, all round a pretty disappointing reconstruction again, but at least the paleontological advisors were thrilled with it. You can tell by the fact that they didn't want to be credited and have never admitted to working on the film. Now, the T-Rex was actually the first dinosaur featured in the film, initially in the form of a skeleton. The anatomy of this skull on this skeleton doesn't seem to match the animal that we see later in the movie in terms of its teeth. But I'm not really going to focus on this skeleton, since we've kind of already talked about the T-Rex to death, and I'm going to draw your attention to the fact that upon finding the Rex skeleton, the protagonist Mills finds a large ungual bone, that being the bone from the tip of a finger, from what appears, based on its length and morphology, to be a therizinosaur. Which is really interesting, since the presence of therizinosaurs in North America during the latest Cretaceous is something that's been suggested by a few fossils, but their identification has always been a bit ambiguous, as discussed in this excellent blog post by Jason Abdale. Paleontologist Andrea Cow suggested in his thorough debunking of the definitely not real Hell Creek Dromaeosaur Dakotaraptor, and yes, I will be working on a video on that soon, that some of the material that made up that dinosaur might have actually been from a therizinosaurid. So it's not at all unreasonable to think that this group of dinosaurs could have been living in Mexico at the time this movie is set, and this is a nice piece of speculation from the filmmakers that I'm glad to see get included. Bye! Bye! Another predator that makes a large number of appearances throughout the movie is one that has confused a lot of people before the movie aired. Considering the fact that the design is almost certainly plagiarized from the tree creepers in Primeval, which were a hypothetical arboreal dromaeosaur, with pretty much exactly the same ecology and habitat as the creature shown here, A lot of people, including myself to be honest, thought that these were supposed to be that, a hypothetical arboreal dromaeosaur. But since the concept art was released, and the title of a track in the soundtrack also gave the animal's name, we have two sources of identification from the film that officially reveal that this animal was something much more interesting, Largosuchus. Now, what was Largosuchus? Largosuchus was a dinosauriform, a close relative of the ancestors of dinosaurs that lies outside of Dinosauria itself. The overall build of the animal in the film is slender and proportionally long-legged, not being too dissimilar from how the real animal looked, except for a few minor differences. To my surprise, the skull of Largosuchus in the movie actually seems to have too few teeth, based on what I was able to find about its close relative and possible junior synonym Marasuchus. Largosuchus should have had probably around 12 maxillary teeth, whereas the animal shown here has 6 maxillary teeth, and then 3 smaller premaxillary teeth. Wait a second, why does the primitive dinosauriform have smaller bunched premaxillary teeth like a tyrannosaurid? What is going on with this design? We then need to talk about the next small, tiny inaccuracy. These things are freaking huge, what the heck? Largosuchus was about the size of a chihuahua. I don't think they're much of a threat, guys. And to make things worse, they lived in the Triassic period, and are a part of a lineage that went extinct at the end of the Triassic. What on earth are they doing at the end of the Cretaceous? They also seem to have broken spines for some reason, and have the wrong number of digits. The Largosuchus shown in the movie only have 3 fingers on their front legs, whilst the real animal, being more basal to the ancestry of dinosaurs, should have had 4 or possibly 5 digits based on its relatives, with only 3 of those digits having claws, a condition which is found in the front limbs of all archosaurs. Honestly, there is so much wrong here that I don't even know where to begin. So I'm not going to. I'm just going to ignore any other details and talk about something else. And I immediately regret doing that, because the other thing that we're going to be talking about is this utterly bizarre quadrupedal predator. Now, I have seen several people claim that this is Phasolosuchus, though it also resembles a large number of other quadrupedal lorikatan crocodile relatives from the Triassic period, such as Pelonosuchus and Prestosuchus. Phasolosuchus is a reasonable candidate, with this genus reaching an estimated 8 meters long and being the largest known terrestrial carnivore in the fossil record that isn't a theropod. In fact, when compared with a human, Phasolosuchus doesn't seem all that out of scale with the quadrupedal predator shown in the movie. That said, it does also closely resemble, perhaps to a suspicious degree, the fictional quadrupedal theropod Arsatis from Dan Falconer and Weta Workshop's World of Kong book. So, if this was just copied from that animal, then maybe it is supposed to be a theropod. That said, I personally think, given the animal's posture and the visible osteoderms present all over its back, that it's very unlikely to be a theropod. As said earlier, the only theropod known to have possessed osteoderms was Ceratosaurus, which was very different from this horrifying creature and lived during the Jurassic. Given these osteoderms and the quadrupedal posture of the animal, I think we can quite safely say that it is supposed to be a lorikatan of some kind. That said, the question then becomes, is this supposed to be a very, very, very late surviving Triassic genus, like Phasolosuchus, or could it instead be something slightly more plausible in the form of a Sebekosuchian? Now, Sebekosuchians were the largest predators in South America throughout much of the Cenozoic, after the dinosaurs went extinct. But the group does actually have a fossil record that goes all the way back to the Middle Jurassic, depending on which lineages you do or don't consider to be Sebekasukians. Now, with the exception of the lineage that led to crocodiles, the high-walking lorikeetans, like Phasolosuchus, were long extinct by the late Cretaceous, with their fossil record only extending until the end Triassic mass extinction event. So logically, this freaky animal has to be an unusually large Sebekasukian. But this also creates another problem. See, the Sebekasukian fossil record is completely absent from North America. We have tons of species from South America, and they're also known from Europe, Africa, and Asia. But to date, none have been found in North America, and we shouldn't really expect to find any in North America, since North America and South America didn't join together until around 2.7 million years ago. Meanwhile, the youngest Sebekasukians, the giant Barinasuchus, seem to have disappeared sometime after 11 to 12 million years ago. Anyway, if we assume that this supposedly scientifically tangible creature is a very, very oversized Sebekasukian, how does it compare with the fossil record? Well, initially my thoughts are kind of positive. The nares, that is the nostril holes, in the skulls of all Sebekasukians are present right at the front of the snout, and that is exactly what is presented here. The animal does, however, appear to have 8 small osteoderms beneath its eye, which is not something the actual animal would have had. The animal also has very prominent shoulder blades, which jut out well above the top of its spine. And whichever group of Pseudosuchians this belongs to, be it a Sebekasukian or a more primitive lorikeetan, the entire way it walks and the structure of these shoulder blades is just wrong, and extremely mammalian. We also need to acknowledge that it has somehow been given a massively incorrect leg anatomy. It only has 4 digits on its front limbs, as opposed to the 5 that are present in all comparable Pseudosuchians, and the 4th digit has a little claw on it, which no archosaurs have. Also, both its front and back legs appear to have a digitigrade posture, wherein the rest of the bones of the foot have been fused and are held above the first 3 digits, with a dew claw also present on the hind limbs. I have not been able to find any evidence for dew claws, that is, these raised smaller toes, being present in any more primitive lorikeetan or Sebekasukian, and both of these groups appear to have had a plantigrade posture, at least on their hind feet, with the whole foot very much touching the ground. I've seen some contradictory stuff regarding their forelimbs, so I'm not going to judge that too much, but it feels like someone has slapped the hind limbs of a theropod onto both the front and back legs of this animal, and it's very strange. It's also worth noting that both the Sebekasukians and the more primitive lorikeetans generally had quite narrow, elongate skulls that were very different from the boxy, almost abelisaurid-like skull present in the movie's reconstruction. So, in summary, this thing is very bad. I can't even say for sure what it's supposed to be due to a lack of any official confirmation. And again, it just feels like a wasted potential to me that the actual ecosystem of Maastrichtian Mexico was sidelined in favor of some kind of Pseudosuchian theropod Frankenstein. Like, this thing has weird leg anatomy, cat-like shoulder anatomy, and whatever it is, it's in the wrong time and place. So, but that's okay. The paleontological consultants of the movie loved it. They loved it so much that they asked not to be credited. Now, the final animal that I want to talk about is one that we only know about because of a single bone that Koa uses to defeat the aforementioned Sudasukian thing. And that bone is a straight, pointed bone with a definite broader boss at the base, which she uses to stab the thing in the face. The fact that this is a disarticulated spike with a broader base means that it is not part of a ceratopsid skull. The only thing it can really be is a tail spike from a stegosaurid. The problem with that is that whilst we know that stegosaurids as a group did definitively live until the early Cretaceous in Asia, potentially even the very late Cretaceous based on some footprints from India, the youngest stegosaur remains from North America are from around 145 million years ago in the Jurassic. What on earth is an apparently fresh stegosaur bone, which is definitely not a fossil because it's light enough for a child to carry and wield as a weapon, doing in the Maastrichtian of Mexico, where these animals had been extinct for around 80 million years?
Stegosaurus had never seen such bullshit before.
Anyway, let's take a diversion to talk about the vegetation that the movie presents, and the general environment. The vast majority of vegetation in this film isn't really identifiable, which is a bit annoying, but there are quite a lot of ferns, which are obviously completely fine for this time period. The only really easily identifiable plant that we see in the film is these pitcher plants, which clearly belong to the family Sarraceniaceae. The inclusion of these pitcher plants in the movie is great, because not only is their lineage known from the Americas only, but molecular clock analyses and divergence time calibrations used in this phylogenetic study of a modern Sarraceniaceae plant indicates that this group first appeared around 88 to 83 million years ago. Meaning that they probably would have been growing in the forests of Mexico at this point in time. No notes then. I am very, very happy to see this plant here. The rest of the plants in the film all look like ones that would have lived in North America at the time, but something very intriguing about the environment shown in the film is how volcanic it appears to be, with multiple geysers and hot springs present throughout the sites our protagonists visit and travel through. As we've said, the film's conclusion demonstrates that the film has to be set in the Yucatan Peninsula in Mexico. So was there a lot of hydrothermal activity in the Yucatan Peninsula during the Maastrichtian? Well, interestingly, we do have some deposits of tiny silica spherules deposited in rocks in Mexico from around 270,000 years before the big meteor smash, as discussed in this paper by Wolfgang Stinnersbeck and colleagues, which I've attached in the description. Stinnersbeck and colleagues noted that they weren't confident about whether these were the result of a smaller precursor meteorite impact, or if they were the result of volcanic activity. If they were the latter, then maybe what we see in this movie is a little bit more plausible. Now, this paper by Fernando Viasco Tapia and colleagues reports volcanic ash beds from northeastern Mexico. But these ash beds have a chemistry that indicates they came from the Laramide volcanic arc, which was on the west coast of North America, not the Yucatan. Heck, I found a whole bunch of other papers which talk about the Laramide volcanic arc and volcanism in the late Cretaceous of Mexico, and they all have that volcanism taking place in the north of Mexico, specifically in the northwest of Mexico and mostly around the Sonoran Desert, not in the southeast around the Yucatan Peninsula. And we have no reason to believe that the late Cretaceous spherules that Stinsbeck and colleagues reported originated in the Yucatan. I found a whole bunch of other papers whilst I was searching for evidence for geysers in the Maastrichtian of Mexico, but all I found was more papers about spherulites of ambiguous origin and about stuff from northwest Mexico. If there was any volcanism-associated hydrothermal activity in the Yucatan, such as is portrayed in the film, I have not been able to find any evidence for it in the geological literature. The best explanation I can find for why there is all this hydrothermal activity in the movie comes from this interview with the directors, who say that they were inspired by Yellowstone and the Pacific Northwest.
We're like, well, how can we not do that? And we started thinking about Yellowstone and Pacific Northwest, where...
And that they didn't want to set their movie in a jungle, because that's been done too often. But the movie is explicitly set around the Chicxa Club impact, which was in the Yucatan Peninsula in Mexico. So why on earth were they inspired by the geology of the Pacific Northwest when trying to reproduce an environment in Mexico? It's bizarre. The movie's comprehension of geography is even more strange, because the co-director and co-writer specifically says in the behind-the-scenes documentary that the movie is set on Pangaea.
Like, they had to establish this kind of Pangean Earth environment, which for...
The supercontinent which broke up throughout the Triassic and Jurassic. But the film is explicitly set at the end of the Cretaceous. The continents were in a position very similar to how they are now. The fact that the creators didn't know this and got their paleo environments this wrong really speaks to how well they were listening to their paleontological consultants. It's no wonder that these consultants were so proud of their work that they had their names taken off the credits. Now that I've talked about the animals and environments more broadly, I want to address my main issue with the film's ecosystem. It is extremely imbalanced. We have a tyrannosaur, a large crocodilomorph, which might be a supersized late surviving lorikeeton, or a freakishly huge sebekasukian in the wrong continent for this time period. We have a very late surviving member of the genus Lagosuchus, a dromaeosaur, a predatory oviraptorosaur, and we have a troodontid. And yet we only see one prey species in this ecosystem, Jacopil, with three others only seen through bones. In the case of this weird corpse, which looks more like a mammal than a dinosaur, and I was so confused as to what it was I didn't even talk about, the therizinosaur claw that Mills finds, and the stegosaur thagomizer that the girl uses. But clearly, the herbivores in this ecosystem are very, very rare. So how is this ecosystem even functioning? As I said at the start, we know from the fossil record that there should be ceratopsids, hadrosaurs, sauropods, potentially ankylosaurs in the Maastrichtian of Mexico, in this area. And yet our heroes only encounter one herbivorous dinosaur in the entire forest. Are you seriously telling me that in an ecosystem made up of tons of tasty plants, which supports two large predators and several other smaller predators, that the actual prey for these species are rare? That is not something seen in any ecosystem on planet Earth today, because it makes no sense. All the predators should be starving to death. The ecosystem is seemingly undergoing a mass extinction event already, because none of these predators should have enough food. The paleontological consultants of this movie were so pleased with how well this ecosystem functions that they asked not to be credited and have never acknowledged their involvement in the film. And frankly, that's heartbreaking. When we look at some of the designs that were originally going to be used in this movie, it's clear that some people involved in the design were very passionate about recreating these animals realistically. And given that so much of the concept art featured Triassic animals, and that we probably have two Triassic animals in the final film, definitely one, it seems pretty obvious that the decision for this film to be set at the Late Cretaceous happened a long way into production. But here's the thing, setting your movie in Maastrichtian Mexico, as we established in the first part of this video, should have given you so much freedom. There's so many fragmentary animals that you can speculate what they look like. There are ceratopsids down there that we don't know what their crests and horns were like. There were Lambiosaurian hadrosaurs that we only have fragments of and no idea what their crests look like. The film even toys with speculative ideas by showing us a therizinosaur claw. A good paleo artist in your design team could have created some genuinely phenomenal, original, speculative dinosaurs that were neither horrifically inaccurate nor could be seen as uncool to a regular audience member, which many of the dinosaurs in this film frankly do to me at least. Like, I see that dromaeosaur and I see a plucked turkey that looks depressed. This movie had so much freedom because of the fragmentary nature of southern Mexico's fossil record, and it squandered it on monsters that didn't look or act like real animals. Monsters was all this movie views ancient life as. There was no respect for the animals. It almost felt like we should view the destruction of the dinosaurs as something to celebrate. Jurassic World Dominion, for all its faults, had a final few scenes which showcased the awe-inspiring spectacle of the dinosaurs and left the audience craving for what our world had lost while treating them in a way that also didn't elevate them above the animals we have now, instead treating them simply as a magnificent part of our world, a world that needs to be protected. And this movie feels like it hates that. It feels like it hates dinosaurs. The movie also feels like it hates geologists and the geological record. At the end of it, we see the asteroid smashing into the land, but we know that it should have actually landed in the ocean just by the coast. We have evidence for the tsunamis it caused in the fossil record. And I don't even know how they messed that one up, because they literally show scenes at a beach, seemingly as though they were originally going to have it crash into the sea, because they're already right by the sea. It's not like it would have been hard to change this and still show the meteorite striking near where our characters are. I want to say now, I do not hate this film, but I hate how little respect it has for the animals. They are portrayed as nothing but monsters. The Lagosuchus, for example, kills a pterosaur and then attacks Koa anyway, despite knowing from seeing Mills shoot a bunch of other Lagosuchus that humans are a much more dangerous prey item, and despite the fact that it logically shouldn't bother killing Koa because it already has food. Okay, that's it. Video is over. If you want more from me, please like and subscribe and support me on Patreon. You get early access to videos like this one, except most of them are more actual science and less ranting about a movie's designs. You get early access to my artworks, and I'll ask your opinions on things going into the videos. I normally give patrons the option to vote on my next video, but some recent events mean that I already know what my next couple of videos are going to be.
I just want to make a few sort of shorter videos debunking some misinformation, and just ones that are a little bit more fun and easier to make, because this particular video got very taxing and quickly became much, much less enjoyable to work on. And I want to have fun and create stuff that I think you guys will enjoy.
A huge thank you to my patrons, Jean and Eric Feenstra. It means a lot that you've still been supporting my channel, even though I haven't been able to get videos uploaded as much as I'd liked. I promise the next few videos will be coming much, much sooner. In any case, I hope you have a wonderful rest of your day. Thank you for checking the video out, and all the best.